Let us see about the compressive strength of concrete. Now let us see what is hardened concrete. When the water is added to concrete, the chemical reaction takes place between cement and water, which is called as hydration, which is exothermic in nature. There is a reaction is exothermic in nature, and due to this the concrete changes from fluid to a plastic state, and finally it converts into solid hardened state. When the concrete becomes hard, it is ready to take externally applied loads. The properties of hardened concrete are strength, dimensional stability, complete stress strain relationship, various moduli, Poisson's ratio, and durability. Now here the diagram shows the concrete at time 0, that is when it is in a fresh state, and at time t after it is set. So here let us see, in short, this shows the aggregate, this is volume of cement, then this blue one is volume of water, and here black one is air voids. Whereas after a certain time t is lapsed, when the concrete has set, the volume of aggregates remains same. However, this volume of cement initially at time t equal to 0, Vc was the volume of cement, whereas here at time t after set, this one is the unreacted cement volume, that is volume of unreacted cement or unhydrated cement, whereas this brown one is hydration products or VHP, that is volume of hydrated products, and this one, the sky blue color, is capillary pores or volume of CP, and this is air void. Now let us see strength of hardened concrete. Strength is ability of a material to resist the stress generated by an external force without undergoing any failure. Concrete failure is indicated by appearance of cracks. The crack is related to the deformation in the body of the concrete. The real criteria of concrete failure is limiting strain rather than the limiting stress. However, the limiting strain is different for different loading conditions and different strength levels. The 28-day compressive strength of concrete is tested by standard uniaxial compression test, and it is accepted universally. The loading process can be controlled either by load or deformation. So this is a typical machine to test the concrete for compression. Now let us see compressive strength and corresponding tests. Failure mechanism. Concrete wide spaces are having various sizes and shapes in the matrix. There are micro cracks between the matrix and coarse aggregates. There are micro cracks in the matrix itself. The failure modes under the loading are really complex to understand. They vary with the type of stress. The compression failure mode is less brittle. Considerably more energy is needed to form and extend the cracks in the matrix. For uniaxial compression test, medium or low strength concrete, when it is tested, no cracks are initiated in the matrix for less than 40 to 50% of the failure stress. That means when the stress reaches 40 to 50% of the failure stress, no cracks are initiated in the matrix for medium or low strength concrete in case of uniaxial compression test. A stable state of cracks, that is shear bound cracks, already exist in the vicinity of the coarse aggregates. As the stress increases, the cracks are initiated in random manner some cracks in the matrix and in the vicinity of the coarse aggregate, that is shear bond cracks, eventually they join up in a narrow region where loading reaches about 80% of the ultimate load, while other cracks are closed. So here it can be clearly seen, this is the picture of a concrete cube, and here we can see the cracks, and these are nothing but the aggregates, and the uniaxial load is applied on that. Matrix is nothing but cement, sand and water together, it is called as matrix. So matrix and coarse aggregates, they form the concrete. Now again going further, major cracks develop in these localized zones in the direction close to the direction of the load. That means the cracks are formed in the direction of the load applied. This signals the failure. That means the concrete cube has failed. Figure 1 shows failure process of a concrete under compression. A relates to shear bond crack when load is less than 40% of ultimate load or failure load. Figure B relates to load initiated cracks, that is load is 40 and 80% of ultimate value, that is between 40 and 80% of ultimate value. Figure C is in connection with crack concentration, that is when the load is more than 80% of failure value or ultimate value. And figure D relates to failure indication, that is major cracks are formed. Now this is nothing but the cylinder. The processes of concrete failure during loading is indicated in this figure 2 when the cylinder is tested under uniaxial compression. There is a vertical crack formation, there are various cracks in vertical direction, and there is a expansion of concrete. Final failure is mostly likely the splitting of the cylinder. Sometimes the failure is due to formation of a shear band. Specimen preparation for compression test. Let us see how the specimen has to be prepared for compression test. Cube specimen and cylinder specimen. In Europe, China, India and some other countries, the cube is specified for testing or for conducting compression test, whereas in America and other countries the cylinder specimen is to be used as per their standard codes. Now cube specimen as per British standard 1881 part 108 1993, it should be 150 mm into 150 mm into 150. We have to pour the concrete into cubic mold in 3 equal layers. Each layer has to be stroked 35 times by a hemispherical tipped steel round rod. It has to be cured at 20 plus or minus 1 degree centigrade, either water curing or any other type of curing, by keeping the temperature at 20 plus or minus 1 degree centigrade. The relative humidity to be maintained is greater than 90%. The cube of standard size, that is 115 to 150 mm, is normally heavy, and therefore sometimes a cube size of 100 mm into 100 mm into 100 mm is used. Each layer is stroked 25 times by a steel rod in this case instead of 35 times. Since it is a cube, it is obvious that height by width ratio is 1, because each cube means each side is same. The 5 surfaces are exposed to the mold, those are smooth surfaces, whereas the top surface is not exposed to mold because it is an open mold having 5 sides. The top face is open, obviously. The cube specimen is tested without surface preparation. Now cylinder specimen as per ASTM, that is American standard for testing on materials, C470-81. The standard size is 150 mm diameter into 300 mm height. The concrete has to be poured in 3 equal layers. Each layer has to be stroked 25 times with the tamping rod. The demolding of the mold has to be done after 16 to 24 hours. Curing has to be done at 23 plus or minus 1.7 degree centigrade in moist conditions. The length to diameter ratio here is 2. That is 300 divided by 150 is 2. 300 is height of the cylinder, 150 is the diameter, therefore height by diameter or the length by diameter is 2. The upper surface of the cylinder is not smooth and therefore grinding or capping is needed. In this case, it is normally found that the cylindrical strength divided by cube strength is 0.8. that means on the same concrete the cylinder strength is 0.8 times that of cube strength. Now let us see what are the factors affecting the measured compressive strength of concrete. First, very important is loading rate. In general, lower the rate of the loading, the lower the measured compressive strength. Deformation generated by loading needs time to develop. If we keep the loading rate as slow, then it allows more subcritical crack growth to occur, and therefore there will be formation of larger flaws, and therefore we get a smaller apparent load, and therefore we get the low strength. If we keep the rate of loading as less, we actually get the strength as low. Because slower loading rates allow more creep to occur in the concrete, strain increases at a given load, and therefore limiting strain is reached, and that is indicated by the failure of the concrete. To make compression results comparable, the standard load rate is to be followed compulsorily. For cylinder, as per ASTM, the load rate should be 0.15 to 0.34 megapascal per second, that is newton per mm square per second. For cube, as per British standard, it is 0.2 to 0.4 megapascal per second, whereas for cube, as per Indian standard, the rate of loading should be 140 kg per centimeter square per minute, or it is 0.233 newton per mm square per second. Now let us see end conditions. The compression test assumes a state of pure uniaxial compression, but it is not really the case. The friction between the ends of the specimen and the platens of the testing machine always exists. The frictional force, due to frictional force, there are differences in Young's modulus and Poisson's ratio, that is E and 1 by M for steel and concrete. Lateral strain in the platens is less than lateral expansion of ends of specimen if they were free to move. Through frictions, the platens restrain lateral expansion of ends of the specimens. This introduces shear stress that is greatest at the specimen end. This shear stress gradually dies out at a distance from each end of approximately root 3 by 2 into D, where D is the specimen diameter in case of cylinder or width in case of cube. The manifestation of this lateral confining is nothing but appearance of relatively undamaged cones or pyramids, which is shown in figure 3A. So this is the cone which is undamaged. Thus, for a standard cylinder with L by D ratio equal to 2, that is length is 300 and diameter is 150, therefore 300 by 150 is 2, only a small central portion of the cylinder shown here is in true uniaxial compression, the remainder being in a state of triaxial stress. Therefore, if we see remaining part of the cylinder, it is not in the uniaxial stress state, but it is a triaxial stress, whereas only a small central portion is in a pure compression state. The effect of end restraint is an apparently higher strength than the true compressive strength of the specimen. That is, because of the end restraint, it gives higher strength than the true compressive strength of the concrete specimen. For ordinary concrete, the Poisson's ratio is approximately 0.2. The lateral tensile strains are occurring at fairly low compressive loads. That could be the cause of failure, as shown in figure 3C. Now, figure 3 shows that influence of constraint to failure mode of concrete specimen. Figure A shows with constraint on both the ends. Figure B shows with constraint only at one end, whereas figure C shows without constraint. So it clearly shows a difference in failure modes. Again, stresses due to end restraints are nothing but apparent conical failure of a specimen. That is, the stresses due to end restraint, they create the apparent conical failure of a specimen. Some end restraints cannot be avoided, so failure occurs through some combination of factors as shown in figure 3b. Tensile cracks may not be able to propagate to areas of specimen under lateral confining stress. Height by diameter or width ratio is different for cylinder compression and tube compression specimens. Constraints, that is patterns of a testing machine to the specimens, are also different. The friction between the end patterns and tube specimen ends, it confines a much greater portion in the specimen than is the case with the cylindrical specimen as shown in figure 4. So this figure 4 shows comparison of the end restraints between tube A, B, C and cylinder D. So figures A, B and C, they relate to cube, and whereas figure D is that of cylinder. Higher strength values when measured on cubes rather than cylinders, that is when the cubes are tested for compression, they give higher value as compared to that given by cylinders. Normally cube strength by cylinder strength is 1.25 for normal strength concrete. Already I told few slides back that cylinder strength divided by cube strength is 0.8. So when we take cube strength divided by cylinder strength, definitely 1.1 divided by 0.8 is 1.25. That means cube strength is normally 1.25 times of cylinder strength for the same concrete. However, for higher strength concretes, it is observed by the research that this ratio is reduced. There is size effect also. Probability of having large deficiencies, that is white sand cracks, increases with the size. More the size, there is possibility of more deficiencies in terms of white sand cracks. The smaller size specimens therefore have higher apparent strengths because there are less chances of cracks and whites because of the smaller size. Results for small size specimens need to be modified therefore. Therefore, a factor of 0.9 is to be used to modify the results. That means when we are using the cubes of small sizes, then since it is less chance of having the cracks and whites because of the smaller size, the literature says that a factor of 0.9 is to be multiplied to modify the results. That means 10% of the strength has to be reduced, only 90% of the strength has to be taken. For this I have referred Advanced Concrete Technology by Jongjin Lee, Concrete Microstructure Properties and Materials by P. Kumar Mehta and P. J. M. Montero, Reinforced Concrete Volume 1 by Dr. H. J. Shaha, Design of Reinforced Concrete Structures by N. Subramanian. Thank you very much.